to the Monday, October 5th edition of the TV on Basketball Podcast with your host, TB. The NBA Finals are well and truly underway, and thank God for Miami Heat for making it competitive. So this will be a lot more to talk about. And yeah, this has been really exciting, and I cannot wait to get into it, especially going to be talking about Jimmy Butler later, so watch out for that. Thank you guys for all your support for on the pod, on the YouTube. That I am eternally grateful for that. And there's a lot of great NBA basketball to talk about today, and I can't wait to get into it. But obviously, before we begin this episode, I have to do my plugging. Remember to follow at TV on Basketball on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram for updates on the podcast and for other content. For all you podcast listeners, if you're an Apple, subscribe, leave a 5-star review. That'd be very much appreciated. If you are listening on Podbean, remember to follow, like, and download. If you're on any of the other ones like Spotify and Anchor, remember to share your support on there as well. And yeah, very excited about these NBA Finals. Been extremely excited watching this. I've gone a bit more on Twitter, but I need to start, you know, tweeting out more and stuff like that. But besides that, I am very much enjoying the NBA Finals, and I can't wait to talk about it today. But yeah, I think that's all the plugging I need to do, so let's get right into this episode. And look, I know that there's other topics you're going to talk about, the Austin Rivers IG Live where he kind of bashes the small ball rocket. Or I could have talked about as well, Buddy Hield ghosting his coach. I'm just going to mention it here. I'm not going to be talking about those today. It is all NBA Finals basketball. And we're going to start that off with Game 2 of the NBA Finals, in which the Lakers, honestly, completely dominated. Even though it was a 124-114 victory, the Lakers dominated. Trust me, if you watch the game, you know. And yeah, so the Lakers won this game 124-114. Again, a repeat of Game 1. Anthony Davis and LeBron James were absolutely phenomenal. LeBron with a near triple-double, 33-9-9 on 25 shots. Very efficient. Anthony Davis, 32 points, 14 rebounds, 15-for-20 shooting. I believe he hit 14 of his first 15 shots. This guy was absolutely phenomenal in this game. And they also got some help from Rondo off the bench, who was absolutely masterful. For the Miami Heat, Jimmy Butler, near triple-double, 25-8-13, 7-for-17 shooting, very efficient. Hero with 17 points in his starting role. Kelly Olynyk off the bench with 24 points, 9 rebounds as well. And Kendrick Nunn with 13. Like I said, the score is very deceiving because the Lakers did dominate this game throughout. And it was a lot of the same from Game 1. Just attacked the paint. Anthony Davis got rebound after rebound after rebound. And the Heat just had no answer for it. They really did try to look out for the role players of the Cavs today just to try and like prevent him from hitting threes. They didn't hit as many threes on a better percentage than Game 1. But they still, you know, did really well, 16-for-47. They literally went rockets mode here and trying to shoot a bunch of threes, only hitting 16 of them, but those 16 threes were very, very crucial to this game. And the thing about this game was that the Lakers, like I said, had full control of this game, and whatever little run the Miami Heat had in them, the Lakers would just counteract. And the Heat were, like, not, like, super far out of it. I don't think the lead ballooned to more than, like, 18 or something. The biggest lead in the game for the Lakers was 18, to be exact. But the Heat just couldn't get out of that, you know, 12-point lead, 10-point, 8-point lead, I think, at most. And then the Lakers would just hit him with something right back, and they just had no answer for it. And like I said, LeBron and AD were the stars, and Jimmy Butler did his best to do the point guard duty, but it just wasn't enough. Let's talk about what the Lakers did good this game, because they completely dominated the paint matchup once again, plus 10 in that aspect. The rebounding battle, they continue to win 44-37 on this one. Not as bad as Game 1. And they just hit enough threes, like I said. They missed a bunch of them. Danny Green, I believe, only hit 1 3 in this game. KCP hit a couple, but on a lot of shots, so not very efficient whatsoever. But they were just able to hit enough. The rebounding matchup was there. And it felt like they weren't in any sort of hole. Like they felt like, oh, the Heat are making their little run. Oh, we have to have some sort of urgency. They really didn't. The Heat just really couldn't get into their offense. And like I said, the game was always in that like 10, 12-point range. But the Heat were just never to get over the hump. And one of the biggest things from this game is, one, Anthony Davis unstoppable. I talked about this after game one. How on earth do you stop this guy? LeBron James, honestly, seeing his box score after the game, I did not know he had a 33-point, 9-rebound, 9-assist game. And the X factor here was Rajon Rondo, who came off the bench, started hitting some threes. And Michael Braun just started to dissect that zone little by little. And they were able to hit 50% from the field. And they were just an absolute force on that side of the ball offensively. Sure, they didn't have the best defense. This is, I believe, Miami's best scoring game of the playoffs. But they were just so good on the offensive end themselves that they basically just outscored the Heat in this one. Rondo was amazing. And honestly, after this game, it really didn't feel like a finals game to me. Especially, like, if you just look at the... before we get into that, let's talk about, the Lakers' con. They never let the game blow, they never really extended the lead too much. It wasn't like game one where after the third quarter, you're like, yeah, there's just no hope for them. It felt like the Lakers were kind of letting them hang around, but at the same time, they were in full control, so that's fine. They need to shoot better from the three-point line. And the free throws, man. I mean, this one, they went 10 for 17. They missed a bunch of free throws, which really kept the Heat sort of in that range. And like I said, KCP and Danny Green struggled. So, yeah, I mean, it was a really good game for the Lakers. They just continued basically off that momentum of the first game, and they were able to play well. For the Miami Heat in this game, Jimmy Butler, what was good about this is that he was trying to get others involved, 13 assists in this game. Kelly Olynyk had a massive game, 24 points and 9 rebounds. This guy was hitting shot after shot. This guy was actually being aggressive, which is a really good sign for this Miami Heat team. They won the free throw battle quite comfortably. They basically doubled the amount of free throws that the Lakers had just because they were being super aggressive in this game. Jimmy Butler as well, I think, attempting 12 of those free throws, so good on them. And they just played with a lot more poise in game one. I mean, it wasn't as many turnovers, under 10 in this game, so good job on them. And it honestly just looked a little bit better from that last game. But again, loss of cons. They were minus 10 points in the paint. They could not handle AD or LeBron. They were getting everything they wanted. A lot of the Anthony Davis buckets, too, were not even him, getting the ball in the post, getting at the top of the key. Nope, they just offensive rebounds. Offensive rebounds was the main story of this game, where the Lakers out-rebounded them offensively 16-6. That was an absolute ugly game for them. And they just could not hold Anthony Davis to, off the board. They had a good initial defensive possession, but Anthony Davis was always there to grab the rebound. Especially if you watch that third quarter, there was, a stretch of two or three plays where it was the same bucket over and over again. I thought, my TV was glitching, and it was, looping the same one. But it was literally just Anthony Davis. A missed shot, grabbed the rebound, put it back in. And Anthony Davis, put back dunk. It just felt like it was the same thing over and over again, and the Heat just could not stop it whatsoever. Jimmy Butler, honestly, in my opinion, this game just was not aggressive enough to, just scoring. I think he really wanted to try to get his teammates involved, but at the same time, man, you're the superstar. You need to hit shots when he needed, and we're going to get into game three later when he did that. No one else could really create for the Miami Heat. The rookies, again, took some ill-advised shots. It just didn't look like they were getting in the flow of the offense. And they never, I talked about how the Lakers really didn't allow the Heat to go in that one run. But that's kind of the thing about this Miami team, and this game at the very least. Just, they were always, in striking distance, but they couldn't get over the hump. And that's what really prevented them from getting this game, to a reasonable range. Because they had chances to get it to, a single digit under a five-point game, but they just couldn't do it. Honestly, I mentioned this, I almost talked about it a bit earlier, but this did not feel like an NBA Finals game. I don't know about you guys. I think I've seen some videos talking about it, but it just did not feel like an NBA Finals game. It felt like a feel-out game for the Lakers, and it felt like, it was kind of like they had a treat for the Miami Heat. They're like, oh, you want it? You want it here? But they just would not give it to them. And the Lakers just didn't look back. They were playing really well, but it just did not have that Finals atmosphere to it. And I think, like I said, the Lakers had full control, and they just weren't going to let it go. The Lakers just looked like they completely outmatched the Heat, especially with those injuries to Bam and Dragic, who we don't know when they're going to come back still. I mean, Bam has shoulder slash neck problems right now, and Dragic still has that plantar fascia tear in his foot. And it just looked extremely grim after game two, to be honest. It didn't look like it was gonna be an easy win for the Lakers. It looked like it was gonna be a sweep. And it just, like, there was just nothing. Like, I was planning to make like a recap video yesterday when I'm like, what is there to talk about? There's just no good storyline. And honestly, that kind of soured me on the series. I'm like, man, we could have, like, after like a great NBA bubble, like it just seemed like, you know, this is gonna be just a disappointing end to the series. And because the Heat just looked like they didn't stand a chance. And the Lakers just looked absolutely dominant. And it honestly, for us NBA fans, especially for fans that were kind of neutral in this, like just wanted to see some good games, it looked very grim and it looked like it was going to be a sweep. But then we go into Game 3, and Game 3 did not disappoint. It honestly was a nice change of pace, a very good game in general. I'm just glad that we got something competitive. Because in this game, the Miami Heat, against all odds, honestly, I mean, people thought this was going to be a sweep. Again, no Bam, no Dragic. They were able to pull out this Game 3 victory, winning 115-104. And oh boy, this was a game and a half. Actually, not even a game and a half. This game was phenomenal for Mr. Jimmy G. Butler. The G stands for Get Buckets. Jimmy Butler was just absolutely amazing in this game. Honestly, best game of his career. I honestly don't have to look back at this just because I know the fact. I don't think this guy's had a 40-point triple-double before, and he did it on the biggest stage in the NBA Finals. This guy finished with 40 points, 11 rebounds, 13 assists, 70% from the field, 85% from the free throw line, 2 steals, 2 blocks, and a big W. This was a superstar game. I don't even have to mention the other players on the team. I mean, shout out to Tyler Hero for playing well in that fourth quarter. Same thing with Kelly Olynyk. But this was the freaking Jimmy Butler show. He was absolutely phenomenal in this game and was able to lead the Heat to a win. On the Lakers side of things, LeBron and Anthony Davis combined for just as many points as Jimmy Butler this game. LeBron, 25 points, 10 rebounds, 8 assists, 8 turnovers. LeBron was absolutely sloppy in this game. This guy was complaining a lot about fouls. And this guy just was not, like, playing on the offensive end. Like, he just looked pretty sloppy, especially in that fourth quarter. Anthony Davis, where did he go? I know he had foul trouble, especially with 3 fouls in that first half. But he finished the game with 4 fouls. Where was the aggressiveness? He finished with 15 points, 5 rebounds, 3 assists. That is third, fourth option numbers, Anthony Davis. That is not acceptable in these NBA Finals from a player of your caliber. Like he was the fourth highest scoring player on this team. Because a lot of their reason why they were in this game was because Kyle Kuzma and Markieff Morris had 19 points apiece, hitting 9 threes combined, and going 12-for-26. They played great in this game and helped keep the Lakers in it. But the Miami Heat just worked harder, worked smarter, and were able to win this game. They came out with the right mentality. They were trying to pack the paint, forcing the ball outside. I believe this was like the first game where they like actually won the points in the paint battle. 52-34 to Miami won this one. That is the game plan. Like I've been preaching, you need them to beat you by the 3. And they were forcing that, which is good on Miami's end. They were aggressive early, and they got off to that early lead. But when the Lakers started coming back, it really did feel like glimpses, like the same vibe as game 1. But the Miami Heat knew. You know, game 1 was kind of an anomaly. They knew that they were better than that, especially when it comes to holding the lead. And they were able to fight throughout this entire game, which is really nice. But the thing about this game was that, you know, the Lakers kind of stuck around. I mean, as much as the Miami Heat is here, I mean, the Lakers are freaking one of the best teams in the league. They're obviously going to stick around. But at this point, the Miami Heat always had a counterpunch to one of those Laker runs, which is really good. Like I said, this is the Jimmy Butler game. This is his best game of his career. Honestly, one of the better finals performances of all time. Like, I don't have, like, a list in front of me of, like, some of the best ones. Some that come to mind are, obviously, like, the Kawhi Leonard. I mean, Kawhi Leonard last year had a few good games. Siakam had a good game last year. There are obviously some awesome finals games probably from LeBron stuff, but this one is definitely like up there as like one of the better ones. And like I said, the Heat just worked hard in this game and were able to come out with the victory. Let's talk about the pros and cons from each team. Miami, they were able to attack early. Jimmy, I talked about in game two, he just wasn't aggressive enough scoring. He tried too hard to get his teammates involved, and he needed to take matters into his own hands. Well, he did. He was able to take matters into his own hands and just be like an absolute superstar. Like, this was his game, which was absolutely great to watch. And just the type of shots he was hitting, like, honestly, like, no matter what he, like, who was on him, he was like, okay, I know what I need to do. Attack the rim, get a foul, which he's done constantly, and or just hit those, like, patented Jimmy post fadeaways, mid-range jumpers. This guy did it all. He didn't attempt a single three, but he was just as dominant as LeBron or AD was in the series. If anything, that's probably the best performance out of anyone in the series so far. Jimmy Butler was that freaking good. And he didn't stray away from still, like, passing it to his teammates. He trusted them, and they hit his shots when it mattered. Like, and that's kind of my next point. Like, they contributed when it mattered. People like Tyler Hero, who was garbage for the first three quarters, hit 8 points in that fourth quarter, 101, a three-point basket, and a nice little layup. Tyler Hero absolutely came up big in that fourth quarter. Kelly Olynyk in that second half was really good, hitting threes, getting to the paint. And Jimmy Butler was honestly just serving up those buckets on a platter. He was absolutely phenomenal. Finally dominated the paint battle, like I said, 18-point differential in Miami's favor. It just made it uncomfortable for AD and LeBron. Like, 11 turnovers in the first half for the Lakers. 11! They made it so uncomfortable, especially, like, what was weird was that the Lakers had 9 in the previous game. So the fact that they, like, forced double-digit turnovers in the first quarter, you just knew that, the Lakers were playing sloppy, and two, the Miami Heat just came out with a whole new type of aggression. And getting Anthony Davis in foul trouble early really didn't mess with the flow, and honestly, he just couldn't get his flow himself going. And he only attempted less than 10 shots. I'll get into that later. But the Heat just did a good job of just making him basically a non-factor, honestly. Like, he had, like, a few good plays in that third quarter where it looked like we were finally seeing that Anthony Davis from game one and game two, but he just never could get into it. And a lot of kudos to the Miami Heat defense on that one. They did really well. And like I said, the first forced turnovers, I believe the Lakers finished with 19 turnovers in this game. And that was a lot. Like I said, the Heat defense was spectacular. But obviously, there's some things that they kind of did bad. You know, they were kind of too nonchalant with the lead. Once they got to double digits, some points, like the Lakers would go like an 8-0 run to kind of bring it back. But like I said, the Heat were able to counterpunch, which was absolutely key in this game. They also, like, the rookies took really tough shots early. A few that come to mind were Duncan Robinson in that first quarter, where he did not get any of his shots in the flow. Like, he just really did force them. It didn't even really look like the type of jumper that he was hitting constantly throughout the playoffs. Same thing with Tyler Hero, he was kind of forcing things. And, you know, that's just a rookie making rookie mistakes. They just need to know, like, to get their shots in the flow and just get better shots in general. Like, you're going to get your shots. You just have to be ready and shoot them, like, when you're comfortable shooting them. You don't have to force it. You have people like Jimmy Butler controlling the game. You just need to take shots when you believe you need to. And also, again, defensive plays, they still got out-rebounded on the offensive end. 11-3, they still really need to fix that. But, like I said, they still made it uncomfortable in the paint. So those offensive rebounds didn't really result in as many baskets as it did in Game 1 or in Game 2. And they just need, like, more ball handler help. I mean, Hero was kind of, like I said, kind of garbage in the first three quarters and played really well off the ball in that fourth quarter, except for that, like, one play where he got an and-one on Rondo where he just completely took him to the rim and schooled him. But yeah, they just need some more ball handler help for Jimmy, because he only played he played 46 minutes in this game, or just under 46 minutes. He played basically every minute of this game, and he was handling the ball for like 90% of it. So if you can have another, you know, ball handler to help out Jimmy at times, that would be great. But at the same time, you know, they were able to get the win, so maybe this is what they need to do. Now it's going to the Lakers' end. Like, let's see what they did well. You know, kind of like how we talked about in the Heat last game, they kind of stayed in the game. But even though they were sloppy, like, just because they're that good of a team, They had good bench help. Like I said, 19 points for Kuzma, 19 points for Morris. And the thing about Markieff Morris, I'm going to put this in right now. He went 5 for 10 from the three-point line. Like, two or three of those misses, like, out of the five, were just horrible. Like, if you watch the game, like, I think he either hit, like, the side of the backboard, airballed it, or something. I don't know. It was just really ugly. But at the same time, he was able to hit 5-3, so that was massive. So, Markieff Morris was a good game, but, man, some of those shots, even though he shot 50% from three, were ugly. And, again, they just won the rebounding battle as they did all series. But now let's talk about the cons, because there's a lot to go here. We're going to talk about the stars a bit later, but let's talk about Danny Green, over 6. KCP was not good in this game whatsoever as well. 5 points in this game, 1 for 5 shooting. The turnovers, 19 turnovers for the Los Angeles Lakers compared to the 12 from the Heat. That's just too many turnovers. They just looked disengaged. They didn't look like they were fully in it. And it just felt like they didn't take it seriously. And what I mean by that is that LeBron James, he had the best game as a on that Lakers team yesterday, 25 points, 10 rebounds, 8 assists. But he was sloppy. And he, I don't want to feed into his narrative because or anything, but LeBron James just didn't want to defend Jimmy Butler in the game. They always, like, LeBron would start off with Jimmy Butler at the top of the key. But whenever the pick came, someone would always switch on. I just don't get it. Jimmy Butler was cooking everyone. And if I'm LeBron, I'm like, yo, you guys have been getting cooked. I got this. And LeBron just always just switched off. I just don't understand. Like, this is the type of moments where you're like, you need LeBron to, like, be super engaged on the defensive end and try to stop their best player. But he didn't. He wasn't up for the challenge. He was cooking KCP. They were the Heat were seeking out that matchup. Whenever he was put onto Markieff Morris, that was over for him. Rajon Rondo, that was over for him. And all of this, like, LeBron just did not guard Jimmy Butler. And that was just really frustrating to watch. Like, I just don't understand why he just didn't want to stay on him. And along with that, I mean, LeBron, the turnovers. He had 3 points in that fourth quarter. He did not play well in that fourth quarter whatsoever. Like, he tried complaining for fouls too much. Like, whenever he, like, lost the ball. He had a couple of turnovers in that fourth quarter where were just really ugly and, like, really halted the Lakers' momentum. It was just not a good game. Even though he probably had, the best game out of any Laker, that was just not a good game for LeBron. And honestly, if it wasn't for the bench, this would have been a blowout. And the good thing was they got some contributions off their bench, but still, that was an ugly game for LeBron, especially that fourth quarter. And I'm not forgetting about you, Anthony Davis. I'm not letting you off the hook because I was going to say that, where's the aggressiveness? Where was it? Game one and game two, this guy was aggressive, attacking the boards, just getting any shot he wanted to over this depleted Miami Heat team. Where was that yesterday? It was nowhere to be seen. He had, a good few good plays in that third quarter. He had 0 or 0. Like, he didn't score until, like, the third, until, like, 3 minutes left in the first quarter. Where was that aggressiveness? And we have to put him to a higher standard because this guy is a freaking superstar, a top five player. He cannot disappear in these moments like this. He needs to stay aggressive. And they cannot have a subpar game from Anthony Davis. He scored 15 in this game, fourth scoring option. You're not winning this way. 19 turnovers, you're not winning that way. LeBron James, if you have 8 turnovers in the game, very unlikely you're going to win that game. Like, it was just a bad game from the Lakers all around. And what was, extremely frustrating as well is that, I don't want to put it all on Anthony Davis, is that LeBron, Rondo, you are the two guards. Why are you not telling him, get your butt into that paint and do what you do? Why was there none of that? Honestly, I was just wondering why there was no, urgency to, get Anthony Davis going because he was the key to victory in those first two games. And he just did not look aggressive whatsoever. I don't remember, any good plays he did in the fourth quarter as well. I mean, yes, he was in foul trouble for the first few minutes, but he still had 2 fouls to give. It wasn't like it was, anything crazy. And they just let they let this game slip away. You gave Miami hope. And that's the last thing you want to give this team, who are extremely confident, have that culture about them. Now they have confidence, and whether Bam is here or not, or Dragic in the next game, at least they have confidence knowing, hey, even without them, we've seen ourselves win, so we could do this again. And now you've given the Heat hope. And honestly, I believe that's a huge mistake. Could it still be a five-game series? Probably. Maybe it is. But still, you don't want to give any hope to the scrappy Heat team. And like, just like conclude thoughts on this game, you know, there was just no urgency. Once AD was down in the first half, you know, he kind of stayed away from the action, which is not good. I'm just so disappointed that LeBron just didn't want to guard Jimmy Butler in those last few possessions, man. I'm really disappointed. Jimmy Butler, give him all the praise you want. This guy, if you haven't checked out his story, please check it out. It's absolutely phenomenal. This honestly felt like the Allen Iverson, like his own version of the Allen Iverson game in from 2001. You know, the step over game where they beat the Lakers in game one. Oh, this is game three, but this is his kind of Iverson moment. Leading this team to the finals and having a performance like that, Jimmy Butler deserves all the praise. And I want that to be the storyline going into this. Not that the Lakers played bad or whatever. I want people to see that Jimmy Butler is that guy. Jimmy G Buckets, the G stands for get. This guy is just phenomenal. This guy is a freaking leader. Whatever the narrative was in his end tenure, like at the end of his tenure in Chicago, whether it's the 76ers, whether it's the Timberwolves, I don't care about that narrative. Jimmy Butler, him as a leader, can lead you to the finals, and he can have, and he is capable for having games like this to lead you to finals wins. Whatever that old narrative was, throw it out the window. Jimmy Butler wants to win. You need to surround him with people with his mentality who want to win, and that's how you're going to succeed. He doesn't want any of this, you know, pixie BS. He doesn't want any, you know, of this soft stuff. He wants to win. And he has that team in Miami, and good for him for finally getting to that point. The Miami Heat keeps their hopes alive. I think they're going to continue to keep games close going into, like, these future games. And one more thing before we got this. That walkout from LeBron, that was immature, honestly. Because I know Jimmy Butler said, like, in the fourth quarter, like, oh, they in trouble. They are in trouble. And he's talked about after game how LeBron basically said in the first quarter after they came back from, like, a double-digit deficit. And Jimmy returned a favor in the fourth quarter. LeBron, you look like that guy from Twitter who wants to talk trash. When someone refutes his point and actually makes a valid point, he just says, shut up. And says, like, oh, stop being my mention and all that. I've seen way too many guys on social media like that. And the fact that you walk off the court before the game was over, stuff like that, made you look immature. Like, there's just so many bad things about this Lakers. Like, it's just not a good look, man. It's just not a good look. Take the L, come back next game. But you do not have to honestly go out like that. And I'm not saying it was a champion, but that will be the narrative today. When I get off this podcast, I'm going to see something on FS1, on ESPN, talking about LeBron walking out, thinking it was like a tantrum. Honestly, I'm not going to be surprised if people like treat it like that. And he put himself in that position, and now the Lakers, you know, could have had a sweep, but now they've given the Heat a little bit of hope, and that's all they need. Now let's talk about the Game 4 preview. What do the Heat need to do to get another win? Keep attacking the mismatches. Keep the Lakers out the paint. You know, make them shoot. 32%, I believe, from the Lakers from the three-point line today. You take those. Just take everything away from the paint. Make them shoot. Take shots at rhythm. Let Jimmy Butler control the offense. And be ready to hit shots, because I believe in the next game, they look at this game and they're like, okay, let's let anyone but Jimmy score. And these shooters around Jimmy have to be prepared to hit those shots. And they honestly have to stay aggressive and get to the free throw line, because I'm not sure if they won the free throw battle yesterday. I know a bunch of Lakers fans were complaining. Yeah, the Lakers fans were complaining about yesterday about the free throws. You had 6 more free throws than them. The fouls are extremely even. I just don't get it, honestly. And yeah, they just have to continue with this game plan and just keep the Lakers out of the paint. And if you're the Lakers, stick to the game plan that won you game one and game two. Get Anthony Davis involved. LeBron, just keep attacking the paint. And you're going to get a lot of good things are going to happen. They have to keep their eye on Jimmy, honestly. Like, let anyone score but Jimmy. I think that should be the mindset for the Lakers, especially if there's no Bam or Dragic. AD needs, like I said, be a big part of that game plan to win that game. start arguing about the calls and actually get back on the plays. Let the other Heat players beat you. And although KCP and Danny Green did not play well in this game, continue to trust those role players, because Kuzma had a good game in this one. Markieff Morris had a good one. Just continue to trust them, and they will deliver, especially if you are confident in the shots that they are taking. Going to game four, maybe the Heat still get a game. I don't know, but the Lakers, I think, are going to come out with a lot more poise in this game, and Jimmy Butler talked about in his post game. Look, the Lakers are going to come out a lot more clean in the next game, and they just have to match that effort, match that intensity. And I believe in the Heat team. I believed in them before the series, and the fact that they won this one, maybe that may be the only game they win, but at least we know that the effort can be there. And with Jimmy Butler as a leader, you never know. Good game for them, and let's see if they're going to be able to come back in the series tomorrow night. And I think this is where we're going to today's podcast. Remember, before you go, the election is coming up. Hopefully Donald Trump is okay. I know the thing he's doing with COVID, no matter who it is, even if it is Donald Trump, you don't want anyone getting hurt or in that situation. So prayers up to him. And, you know, there's still a lot of stuff going on in terms of social justice. Remember to vote. Remember to pressure your politicians. Make sure these changes are here. I know the NBA Finals have been awesome, but remember that there's bigger issues at hand, and we all need to work together to help combat those. But yeah, I think this is where we're going to end today's podcast. Thank you guys for watching or listening. Remember, if you're on YouTube, like, share, and subscribe. You know what to do for the podcast networks. Those can be found in my link tree. And just, like, show your support on all of them. And remember to follow at TV on Basketball on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Thank you guys for all your support. I will be back on Friday with another podcast. And you might see like a cool video or two from me on YouTube today, on this week. So watch out for that. I'm extremely excited for more NBA basketball, and I cannot wait for more NBA Finals action. But yeah, I think this is where we're going to end it. Thank you guys for watching and listening. I hope you all have a fantastic day. TV signing out. Peace.